Good morning and happy Easter to you. I'm Reverend Kyle Nesbitt from the Herkimer Reformed Church, and I'm joined by
Reverend Brian Engel from the Mohawk Reformed Church.
I just wanted to take a moment here before we enter into this sanctuary at the Fort Herkimer Church to remind you that, you know, on this first Easter morning, the disciples of Jesus that went to the tomb were not going with joy and elation. They were heading to a cemetery, and they're not exactly known as weekend hotspots for a family picnic or anything like that. They were going with grief, sorrow, frustration. The funeral of their best friend and teacher had been postponed due to the circumstances around his death. And if you can relate to that in the midst of our current circumstances, I think you would have been in good company with these disciples. But if you can relate to their grief and frustration now, then I've got good news for you, because though they went expecting sorrow and closure, they found something so joyous, so world-changing, that we celebrated every Lord's Day, even now, 2,000 years later. So join us, won't you? We're going to head into the sanctuary and hold an Easter worship service. Lord God, early in the morning, when the world was young, you made life in all its beauty and terror. You gave birth to all that we know: sky and seas, plants and trees, bodies of light in the sky, creatures of the land, water and air, man and woman.
In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, and it was so. God saw that all he had made, and it was very good. Thus, the heavens and the earth were completed in all their vast array. By the seventh day, God had finished the work he had been doing. So on the seventh day, he rested from all his work.
We stand in awe of your creation and give thanks, O Lord.
Early in the morning, when the world least expected it, a newborn child crying in a cradle announced that you had come among us, that you were one of us. The angels proclaimed it, the shepherds heard it, and in obedience worshiped.
Joseph went up to Bethlehem with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told.
We stand in awe of your incarnation and give thanks, O Lord.
Early in the morning, surrounded by respectable liars, religious leaders, anxious statesmen, and silent friends, you accepted the penalty for doing good, for being God. You shouldered and suffered the cross, and with the words, "It is finished," you put an end to our hopeless state of death, giving instead the promise of salvation and life.
Consider the heart of Christ Jesus, who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped. Rather, he made himself nothing. By taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a human being, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross.
We stand in awe of your sacrifice and give thanks, O Lord.
Early in the morning, a voice in a guarded graveyard, empty cloths and footsteps in the dew, proved that you had risen, that you had come back to those and for those who had forgotten, denied, and destroyed you.
God raised Jesus from the dead, freeing him from the agony of death because it was impossible for death to keep its hold on him. God has raised this Jesus to life, and we are all witnesses of the fact. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead.
We stand in awe of your resurrection and give thanks, O Lord.
On the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you."
Go in awe of creation, incarnation, death, and resurrection of our God, and give thanks. For God has raised Jesus to life, and we are all witness to the fact.
So, people of God, the first Easter was not celebrated necessarily with joy and jubilation first thing in the morning in a crowded church building. No, we actually find most of the disciples were scattered and distraught, all doing their own thing, but at the end they were found together, huddled, locked behind closed doors in their own house. out of fear. So if you find yourself in their situation right now, I've got good news for you here, because Easter is what ultimately changes our perspective on everything. I'm going to leave you with this exhortation from Paul to the church in Corinth. He has this to say in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 14 through 20. Now, if Christ has not been raised, then our preaching is in vain, your faith is in vain. We are even found to be misrepresenting God, because we testified about God that he raised Christ, whom he did not raise, if it is true that the dead are not raised. For if the dead are not raised, not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile and you are still in your sins. Then those also who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. If in Christ we have hope, in this life only, we of all people are most to be pitied. Now, if is a very powerful two-letter word that Paul starts this whole series of points out with. And if Christ has not been raised, this is the perspective we have in the world. One, your faith means nothing. Rotting your brains in front of the television while eating diabetes and heart disease on a platter would do you better than any time you could spend praying right now while you are isolated and in quarantine. Two, Brian and I are misrepresenting God. We are liars. You would make a better God than the liar we proclaim. Three, you are still under the curse of sin. You will not escape the judgment that is coming into the world. Four, death has the final word in every person's life. That graveyard we crossed coming in here is going to stay like that until everything is turned to dust. And dust it will remain. And five, we are the most pitiable people on earth if all our lives we have hoped in Jesus. Christians are merely misguided and gullible at best, and fanatic and detrimental at worst. However, if is a big, heavy-hitting word, there's another one that Paul uses that leads us into this next verse that I'm going to leave us on here. It's a really heavy hitter. It's the word but. Now, I know some buts are heavier than others, but I'm talking about the three-letter version here. But, he says, in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. Now, if Easter is true, if what we're celebrating here is not in vain, if in fact Christ has been raised, we can go back to those 5 points that Paul talks about and flip them over on their heads, and we get 5 very great points of good news that are worth celebrating here. One, our faith is not worthless. It's the most valuable thing we possess. It's worth trading everything we have for. It's worth living and dying for, actually. Two, Brian and I are not lying. We're actually proclaiming the God who raised Jesus from the dead. He is the greatest being in the universe, and he's worthy of all our worship and adoration. Three, you are not any longer under the curse of sin. Jesus has atoned for your sins with his death. And you will pass through judgment. Four, death does not have the final say in your life. Jesus Christ does. And that cemetery we walked through that was bare, empty, cold, will be teeming with life. When Christ returns, all the dead in Christ will be raised and be shouting hallelujah. And five, we are not pitiable people. we are actually to be envied, because we experience now the hope and the joy and the foretaste of the resurrection, even in the midst of sorrow and lament. So if Christ has not been raised, then we have a lot to contend with right now and much to despair over. But since Christ has been raised, then much has been contended with by God, and we have much to rejoice over. We can see why witnessing Jesus' death meant much despair for the ones who loved him, but in light of his resurrection, I hope you can believe what they believed, experience the joy that they experienced, and bear witness to the gospel to which they testified.
May the grace, may the peace, love, and hope of our Lord be with you all. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen.